Welcome to City Voices interview with Issa Ibrahim, artist, writer, musician, psychiatric survivor, and author of The Hospital Always Wins. I don't know if that's captured there. I'm holding up the book.
Yeah.
Now, the Hospital Always Wins is the subject of this evening's interview. Hi, Issa.
Hello, Dan. Hello. How are you?
All right. And, you know, we got to skip the pleasantries, Issa. We got to get right to it because we only have an hour. And I mean, maybe, but this is not like your answers, your responses, take as long as you want, you know, flesh it out, whatever, wherever the spirit leads you. If any, is it possible to maybe do a part two to do the rest of the questions if we don't finish?
If you're so inclined, if you think I'm interesting enough to invite me back, then I'll certainly take up your offer and come back for a second interview.
Cool. All right. So how did this memoir come to be?
Actually, in 1990, when I was first introduced into the system, there was this aide in Kings County Hospital where I was temporarily housed to decide competency in my case. And he come and saddled up next to me and he said, you know, I read your chart. I said, yeah, I automatically got defensive because it's a very dark and very heavy story. So I immediately got defensive. And he said, yeah, I read your chart. Yeah? Yeah. Make a good book. You should write about it. That was in 1990. And so I started writing, not so much out of his suggestion, because I realized that it was a cathartic experience writing this experience that I went through and trying to understand for myself, you know, because I was seen by a gaggle of doctors, so many doctors and psychiatrists who wanted to know what happened, what was going through your mind and labeling me and diagnosing me, but I didn't have a firm understanding of myself really to know what really happened. So that's why I started writing it in 1990. And I've been writing and rewriting and refining it over 20 years before I finally had it in a shape where I put it in the hands of a literary agent by sheer chance. And he said, you know what? Usually in cases like this, we have a ghostwriter who you sit down and talk to with, and you dictate it to him, and he do the writing. And I said, but he said, this writing is so good, we're gonna let you write your own book. And that was like, you know, the highest praise I think he could have gotten at that time for me.
Issa, what is your advice for young Black men entering the mental health system for the first time?
Good question. You know, now is such a very, very, very important time that we're living through, in that when I was going through the system 30 years ago and the last 20, 30 years ago and onward, it was taboo. You didn't talk about race. It was like, you have a mental illness. It's all a medical model. Race has nothing to do with it. We treat everybody the same. And they almost gaslit you into thinking, if you've got a problem with race, then that's your problem. But now, Black people today going into the system have a more refined understanding of the system, I believe, or at least the systems that exist that they can find themselves in. So, get out any way you can, and then seek help the best way you can, the best way that sits with you. And that may be, unfortunately, getting out the only way you can would be strategically thinking about how to get out. And for some people, that the only way is to take their meds and give them what they want so that they'll say, okay, he's taking his meds, he's fine, now we can move towards letting him out. I mean, if you fight it, if the system is kind of too big to fight alone. And more often than not, Black men find themselves alone in the system, and it will eat you up and spit you out. So I don't want to be the one to say take the meds, but get out of there the best way you think you know how. Be strategic. Treat it like chess. And chess means losing some men sometimes, losing certain battles, or giving up certain things, making sacrifices. And for some people, that sacrifice may mean taking the meds or acquiescing just enough so that they feel that you're safe enough to go back on the streets. So it's a delicate balance, you know. There is no one clear answer, but that's probably the best thing I would suggest. Get out of there, because it's not your friend.
Well, you got out of there. Being a gifted artist helped you to survive and eventually bust out of Creedmoor Psychiatric Center, which is a long-term state facility. Some people spend their whole lives there and die there.
Yes.
Were you not an artist, how could you have won your freedom?
You know, I have to say, my case is such, I don't want to sound like my case is unique, but to a large extent, my case is unique, because there are plenty of brothers who were there years, decades before me, and others who came after me who are still there, who didn't have a talent that they could monetize and then hire a lawyer, use some of that talent and the money that they made with that talent to buy a computer, to then research independent psychiatrists, to then hire an independent psychiatrist, to then mount a case and get out. So resources are very important. And my case was unique in that I had a talent. I found ways to sell my artwork. I saved that money. I didn't spend it on anything except computer access and then internet access, which I kept under the radar of the hospital, and then researched independent psychiatrists to get out. So if you're in there, make friends, make connections, reach out to people, have help, because I couldn't have, without getting help from people that I'd made friends with, had someone bring a computer into me, and then the internet access, which is kind of smuggled in. So, keep those connections up. Keep those, even if it's just your mother and your family, for God's sake, stay connected to your family. I mean, the reason I was so desperate and so dire is I lost my family. My family abandoned me. So I realized I had to make friends. And I was a decent enough character and a decent enough person to, when people met me, realize, well, let me give this guy a shot. I'd always be upfront about what I was there for. I never skirted around it. I wanted to be upfront and honest so that they could make an informed decision about whether they want to help me or not, or be involved with me or not. You know, and that took a lot, but also that was a part of my healing. You know.
So you were in Creedmoor for like 15 years, right?
Almost 20.
Almost 20, okay. And then you managed to get out against the odds. And yeah. You returned to community life, and you've been living in the community for a number of years.
Yes.
So my question is, are you as free as you'd like to be right now?
Actually, I've got chains on my feet that are pretty heavy, in that I have a criminal component to my case. So the New York State and New York Queens County District Attorney are involved in my life. I can't move without the district attorney approving the move. I have to go through all sorts of boards at Creedmoor to then take it to him, the district attorney, to then have him decide, okay, yeah, I think he can move there. I can't leave the state. You know, every 5 years they re-up my case, and if they decide that they want to hold on to me still, which they have done already twice, then that's it. I can't leave the state. But I can petition, I can ask for and have gotten permission to go to Amsterdam, they sent me. I went to Montreal Film Festival. So I can leave the state if I ask. So I mean, to get back to the way you phrased your question, and thank you for phrasing it that way, I am living as free as I feel I need to. You know? I am free. I mean, I don't feel any tendrils holding on to me, even though I am tethered to a system still. But I don't feel it. I don't allow it. I don't allow that to permeate or to pierce my defenses. Yeah. And if I were, and like I say, I'm so fortunate to have created a profile with this book and the movies I made and the paintings I've done, so that the people at Creedmoor almost have no choice but to let me go when a letter comes from somebody in Montreal or Amsterdam with on official letterhead saying, we want this guy, we need this guy. They have no choice. Okay, let him go, yeah. So I'm breathing rarefied air, believe me, I know it.
The word Mahada appears a lot in the book, and it's used to describe the hospital personnel. Yes. I wasn't familiar with that word to describe hospital personnel until I read your book. It the word sounds a lot like Mahatma, which means a holy person in South Asia.
Isn't that
Mahatma Gandhi?
Right.
How did this word come to mean what it does?
Actually, it's the furthest thing from Mahatma you can imagine. it's an acronym. What do they call it? Acronym, Mental Health Treatment Aid.
Oh.
Mahata, Mental Health Treatment Assistant or Mental Health Treatment Aid.
Oh. Okay.
So it's kind of like one of those weird acronym that to portmanteaued together and made up its own word.
Because if it's an acronym, then why didn't you capitalize every letter? Did you
just to kind of give you a nice flavor of how it was said in the hospital, as if it were a word and not necessarily an acronym. Because they called themselves Mahadas. You know, at one point, Creedmoor and New York State psychiatric facilities were so huge that the Mahadas were a major workforce, and they had these little mini towns. Creedmoor was a mini town at one time, where it was overrun by people who worked there who named themselves or somehow were named Mahadas, and it stuck. And when I was there, I just came upon that word and decided to use it in the book as also a respectful nod to the few decent ones who worked there, because there were some decent people.
Yeah, they helped you out a little bit.
They did.
So what's your relationship with marijuana today? In the story, you say it is one of the factors that led you to losing your grip on reality, like quote unquote reality. That what many consider a benign drug can actually cause real harm.
Yeah. That's the thing. I forget the percentage, so don't quote me on this, but I think it's like 20% or 25% of the population of the world have an allergic reaction to marijuana. It's not huge, but it's considerable in that most of the world are smoking to their heart's content, and God bless them, because my parents came from that world of the beatniks and then later on the hippies. So that's kind of how I was introduced into the home. But I have a predisposition to addiction in that I can't just smoke one joint and chill. I find myself coming down and needing more. And then after I've smoked a lot of it, I get psychotic. And that's what led to the experience that I had and have had since then. In the hospital, I came upon some marijuana. You know, you tease it out. Because when you're there for a couple of years and it's free-floating all over the place, and even the Mahatas are selling it, you think to yourself, wow, maybe it wasn't a pot. Maybe it was something else. Maybe I could smoke it again. And you get a hold of it and you smoke it, and I flipped out. And it was kind of like a wake-up call. Wow, okay, I can't smoke this. It was the pot, So that was a hard lesson to learn, and it was a hard lesson to learn while in the hospital. Because then they say, okay, this guy's no effing good, he's still smoking drugs and he's So that kind of was a bad black mark on my record, and makes one of the reasons why they test my urine like maybe twice a year or every, you know, random urinalysis.
So the way they'll do that, they randomly do it.
They haven't done it in at least 8 months, not since COVID, but you know, if they want to, they can, and they will eventually, I'm sure. Just keep going your toes, you know.
Yeah.
And it's something that, like I say, I have to say, I grew up with it. You know, my parents were beatniks. My parents were, you know, they were cool parents, you know. So, and all the people who came around them, the musicians and the artists and the writers, would smoke and talk and just have one and play music. It was a wonderful environment. So it's very much a part of my upbringing and how I relate to things. So to give that up was hard. And I still feel the pangs. Like if I'm walking on the street and somebody's smoking something, I pass them. It like creates a, wow, hello, you know. It's deep in my bones because it's the smell of my home. But I also am wise enough to know that if I start again, it may create a problem. So I've just got to be smart, be wise enough to know that I can't play with it.
Gotcha. Can you explain the male sexual desire, the Oedipal desire some men have for much older women, like your therapist Gaia, who represented the symbolic mother figure?
Yeah. Well, it's going back to the womb. It is, you're right, it is an Oedipal desire. And with me, I just lost my mother in a very tragic and horrible way, and I was alone in this hospital where I saw violence and abuse and neglect. Then all of a sudden, this older woman, old enough to be my mother or grandmother, actually, she was that much older, was showering attention on me, you know, which became a sexual attention. Or it was moving in that direction, and I just followed it. I was young and stupid enough to not know that you don't mess around with your therapist, you don't mess around with staff members. And so it just went in that direction, and we paid the price for it.
You paid the price, but at the same time, you cultivated one of your staunchest supporters.
Yes.
Who I believe she was essential in helping you achieve what you did.
Yes. Yes, she was. She was. You know, and to this day, there's an ambivalence. You know, she's a beautiful person, and she cultivated my art career in the early days when there was nothing but just a few drawings and a few paintings and no way to photograph it. So she gets me a camera to photograph and make slides. So she really cultivated it. But at the same time, there's also that ambivalence of her getting something out of it.
Oh, okay.
You know, and I mean, I don't want to. I'll love her to death, and she's still alive. She's in a nursing home upstate. And occasionally, I still talk to her. There's that thing of God bless you for helping me and allowing me to have something to build on to then years later get out of the hospital, because I would never have done that. And yet she was skimming some off the side, you know, getting a little something that she needed, which, and God bless her, since, you know, she needed love, and she needed attention, and she needed affection, and she needed sexual attention, sexual healing, and she needed those things. And so she approached it so that she got what she wanted, I got what I wanted, and it didn't seem like anyone was being used. Yeah.
How would you characterize your relationship to women? Their importance in your life, their positive impact as well as negative, if any. Can you imagine, and can you imagine a life without women?
No. I mean, my mother was my staunchest supporter prior to God. My mother just cultivated me to be this artist. You know, and growing up in being born in 1960, I'll just take an aside before I answer that question. Being born in 1965 and growing up in the late 60s and early 70s, she never gave me the talk that a lot of Black women before then and after then give their male children about talk nice to the cops, don't you know, and filling them with fear and lowered expectations of, remember, you're a Black man, so you're not going to go anywhere in this world, or you got to try to talk, yeah. My mother never gave me that talk. She raised me to look people in the eye, white people in the eye, or anybody in the eye, and just say, I've got something to offer. I'm an artist. I'm also a musician. I do this. I do that. Maybe we can work together. And just, those are things I learned later the hard way, you know. But so she really cultivated me to be an equal. And maybe even a better than equal, or someone with something to offer that she's presenting and she cultivated, as if to say, this is my son, and he's a bad mother, you know. And so I just dedicated everything in my life to her. And as far as like women in my life, I've always, respected my sisters growing up. They would read Erica Jong and Gloria Steinem, all these pre-feminist and proto-feminist writers at the dawn of the feminist movement, you know, in the early 70s and stuff. They'd sit around the table and have meetings talking about with their other female friends from college, talking about the feminist movement when they were burning bras back in the old days, you know. So, I mean, they test drove a lot of that stuff on me because I was always under the table drawing. So I was always listening to that, to the rhetoric. And it was more than rhetoric. And now going back to being Creedmoor and finding Gaia and another young lady, help me out, and then having a partner for the last 25 years, Susan, who I'm living with currently, and she's out shopping. Now, women are my muse. Women are my, without getting too binary, you know, without getting too in that area, although I can't help it, we need each other. The male needs the female to continue the procreation that kind of keeps us going. I don't want to get too like how important that is or how essential that is, because that's up to you. I mean, the viewer. And God bless you any way you want to go, you know. But being a heterosexual male, I grew up, and showing my age now, I grew up with a certain understanding and appreciation of the female, the feminine, and their importance to the masculine, and vice versa, the masculine's importance to the feminine. That was a tough question.
Is there a comparison to be made between you mentioned her real name, but in the book you call her Lily, between your relationship with Lily to that which your parents had with each other?
Yes.
Yes, I see it every day. Not only that she looks just like my mother, which I took a therapist to figure that out. I brought a picture of my mother once into one of my therapists. And she had met Susan like maybe months before in the joint session that we had. And the first thing she said was, "Oh, it looks like Susan." I was like, "Whoa." And then I saw it and I can't unsee it now, you know. And she's so much like my mom in her relationship to my dad, like how we relate. You know, she's my rudder. She's my bullshit detector. She's my biggest fan. She'll tell me the truth, you know. And that's how my mom and my dad was just almost, and she never met my parents, Susan, but Lily in the book. But yeah, it's stunning how much, and she says the same about me and her father. She sees similarities in me to her father. So it's the old Freudian thing where the male finds his mother, the woman finds her father. So we are a true Freudian household.
Is there any plans to get married?
Who knows? At the moment, no, but we've been together for 25 years, so we're all married in each other's hearts, you know.
Of course.
We are the ones for each other. She often says that that's just like a piece of paper, you know, it's just like a ceremony.
Yeah. That's how I feel about it.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, you call her Lily in the book, so I'm just going to call her Lily.
Yes, yes, yes.
Has Lily read the book, and like, what was her reaction to you? You have some critical commentary on her character.
The thing is, as much as memoirs are supposed to be accurate to true life, and usually are, it's your memory. And memory can be not false, but open to interpretation or intrinsic to the person remembering it, and not necessarily the other people involved. I've already had that problem with other people who worked at Creedmoor, who certainly feel like this book is not an accurate portrayal of what went on in there. She's read it, and she's also listened to the audiobook, which was a much more fruitful experience, you know, that we've spent like almost 8 or 9 hours straight listening to the audiobook. She's satisfied because she feels like it's her, but it's also not her. She felt very compromised initially when I started writing it, that I was putting too much personal information about her in there, and she had her own plans to write a memoir, which she's going to do. So she asked me to alter details. So there are altered details, which take it more and more away from her, or gives it more distance from her. As far as the critique, I really want to be honest, not only about other people, but about myself, my own failings, my own, and what I try to be honest. So the critical things, are what they are, you know, and everyone has an opinion. Those are just my opinions and my critiques.
Okay. Here's a fun question. Although you were awkward with women in your youth, as we all were, right? You grew into a man that many women found irresistible. For those of us who could use advice in this area, what is the secret to attracting and having relations with women?
You know, I think a lot of it had to do with the fact that I was a man in a box. I was a man in a box. I was the perfect man in that I was always there and I could not go anywhere. And I could be compartmentalized in these women's lives. And they could still have their husbands, their children, their job, their mortgage, their car note, and just come to this man in a box. And I personally tried to be as, I was looking for love. So I was, they were loving relationships. But I really do feel that a lot of it had to do with the fact that I wasn't going anywhere. And I'm sorry, you were what? I wasn't going anywhere.
Okay.
And I was the perfect man in a box.
Well, I wouldn't say perfect because one of the major concerns women have in relationships is that you be loyal. And you were in a box, but there were a lot of other women around, and you messed around a bit.
Right. Well, yeah, that was my infidelity, which I like to think that I've quelled that over the years. But I was a young 20-something-year-old person, and when you're 20-something, this is going back 25 years now. When you're 20-something, it was an interesting time. It's interesting you brought that up because I was so shy. I grew up very shy and insecure. And I get to this, it's like I stepped into a different universe. And all of a sudden, because it was a little bubble town, a bubble city, where people came in there to work and were looking for a little nookie on the side, all of them, or most of them, and a lot of them were getting nookie on the side when they were going there. So I just got embroiled in the nookie. Mm-hmm. So it was a very incestuous place. And it was intrinsic of, I don't know how workplaces are nowadays, but in the 90s and 2000s, workplaces were like that. I think a lot of workplace relationships have been quelled and toned down and stopped. Maybe, I don't know. But at the time, everybody was having sex with everybody. And I just got wrapped up in that.
So it's an institutional thing, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So tell us about the rituals of your life. Your story has some remarkable rituals in it, especially during your experiences in extreme states of being. Do you have rituals in and out of those states?
I'll tell you, even though I'm on a moderate dose of Haldol, which is a very heavy tranquilizer, and I have been since 1998 consistently, someone out there listening to this would say, oh, well, he's just kind of not on enough, or he's going in and out of psychosis. But I feel like I'm very well medicated and my mind is pretty tight. But there are moments where I'll channel it lowers and you can see a little bit of what's out there that you saw before. I'll peek behind the curtain and see that thing that drove me crazy that now I'm getting used to. That's still frightening because it's a whole other experience and a whole other life and a whole other type of life and a whole other mode of being. So it's still frightening. But for the last 30 years, I've flirted with that or been privy to that at various times in my life. So it's not as frightening. And I always hold on to God whenever he allows me to see that. I say, God, please don't let me slip. And he'll just kind of raise it again. So and that's what helps me.
Do you have rituals that allow you to get in the right frame of mind to produce art?
Yes, looking at the canvas, looking at a black canvas, blank canvas, or blank wall, or blank piece of paper, and imagining, I guess is what it could be, what the picture is, and seeing it take shape, so that by the time I'm painting it, it's just work. I allow my imagination to kind of imbue itself onto the canvas, so that I'm just kind of doing the work after, and it's not really hard work because I've already seen it.
Are you familiar with Zen at all?
Yes, Zen Buddhism, yeah.
Do you get into like a Zen, like trance-like state when you're producing?
Kinda.
Can you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah. Where I won't eat. I'll need to finish the entire, the interesting thing about the work that I do is that I'll work on a painting until it's done. I won't stop. So I won't eat, I won't sleep. And time is like not time anymore. There's no time. And after 6 or 8 hours, and probably like 8 or 10 in the morning, after I started at 10 in the evening and worked all through the evening or the early morning, it'll be daylight again. I'll notice because there's a certain energy in midnight hours that I've noticed that's different from the daylight hours.
The witching hour?
Witching hour. I'll tell you. It's real. And I coast on that so heavy, you know? Yeah. And that's when my girlfriend goes to sleep. And she doesn't like to talk about witches and the witching hour and deeply spiritual or deeply, you know, she doesn't want to go there because it's so frightening. Mm. She hasn't quite gotten her hands on it yet. Mm-hmm. And only through me has she found the temerity, the strength, and the courage to talk about those things. But even still, she just won't touch it because for some people, it's just too hot to touch.
What was it about Paul McCartney that made him your favorite musical artist?
I grew up a Beatle kid. I was born in 1965, and in the late 60s, that was all that was on the radio. And then my sisters played those records. So it was on the radio, it was on the records. When they turn the TV, he's on Ed Sullivan. Their cartoons. So I love the Beatles. And the music is just, it's not about the music that's just really deceptively simple. Deceptively simple. But as I became a musician and started to play it, I realized, whoa, this is deep stuff. This is hard. It's hard to come off simple. And they just cracked the code. And he was my favorite because he was cute. Mm-hmm. And he had a beautiful voice, and he had like a sentimentality, which he was very later derided for in his career. Like, oh, he's just so twee and so corny. But there was a beautiful sentimentality about him that Lennon didn't have. Lennon was aggressive. Lennon was rebellious, which they needed each other, that sentimentality and that rebelliousness to kind of create what they created. The perfect union. But Paul was just a sentimental kid who, like myself, probably from the suburbs, who just wanted to go back home. You know, and so I really, he's my spiritual, if there's like the experience, that expression, who's a spiritual beetle? You know, because the four of them are like four archetypes, you know, and there's usually one archetype that we all gravitate toward. I gravitate toward that archetype, the sentimental.
Tell us about like the name each beetle and tell us what their archetype is.
Well, John is the cynic. You know, Paul was the charmer. George was the thinker. And Ringo was the clown. Okay. And you stew that all together and you get a perfect thing. You get the entire picture, you know? And I guess I, in my, as a child, I was, I, I,
I gravitated to his sentimentality, but as an adult, as a 20-something-year-old, I became the charmer. Uh-huh. I became my own Paul McCartney, and it's just so weird how that just kind of came into it. And now, as an adult, as an older person, I just want to go back home to find the comforts of your childhood, you know? And I've gotten very mawkish and sentimental and corny almost in a lot of things I've written and painted lately. But it's like the archetypes. And he was the archetype that I most fell in line with.
Was Scarlett the first love of your life?
Yes, most definitely. Most definitely. Yes, she was. And I wish her only the best. I haven't reached out to her at all. I found her on Facebook, but I wouldn't dare reach out. But she was a very good woman. Very good woman.
Is she married? What do you know about her right now?
She's not married. She had a child. Yeah. But she's not married. But I think she's in a relationship with someone. Thanks to Facebook, you can find these things out because it's got the relationship with emoticon, you know, mm-hmm. in a relationship. So I wish her only the best. I wish her only the best. She was very patient with me. But she was on a different track. You know, she really would have liked to have gotten married, had children, which she later did, meet the family kind of thing, form an alliance, the old school way of getting married to somebody. So like two freaks getting together and finding their way. This was very, you meet my family, I meet your family, we get together. And you know, and it was kind of old school-y and not, I wasn't ready for that really.
How is it that you were not swept up in the crack epidemic while your brothers were?
I saw what it did to them. I saw what it did to other friends of mine who started smoking, and I believe the hype. I watched, I'm a media whore. I love the media. I still watch the media. I watch CNN all the time. And I watch the news, and I don't say I believe everything I see on the news, but when they put the fear of God in people in the 80s, like, for God's sake, smoke it once, you'll never come back. I was like, ooh, really? You know, once again, the Paul McCartney kicked in, you'll never go back home? Yeah, you'll never be able to go back home? Huh. So I avoided it while becoming a heavy marijuana smoker. Uh-huh. So, I mean, I had my own crack epidemic in marijuana.
Was there one time, I think you were in a car and someone passed you the spliff, and was it laced with crack?
Yes, I believe that was my brother. That was my brother. He picked me up at my job. My old job was a manager of a record store. Remember record store? And as he was driving and smoking, he passed it to me and I smoked it and I tasted something strange in it. And I felt something come over me that was not like the usual high I felt. And I believe, he never admitted it, but I believe he passed me a lace joint with crack.
Now, is this the brother you call Cal in the book?
Yes, my middle brother.
Let me ask you about Cal. Mm-hmm. He had a military career. How did he manage a military career while being addicted to crack?
Apparently, there was a lot of people doing that. Apparently, there were a lot of people who would come home on leave and drink and smoke and carouse and have their fun, only to go back to the regimentation of the military.
Did the military have drug testing?
I don't know. That's something I don't know. I never asked them, and I wasn't really aware of drug testing at the time to know. Let's see. That's really for those who are reading the book. I don't know if the military was drug testing, but he was definitely doing drugs when he was coming home and then going back into the military. I think it's common, I think. I mean, drugs are such a perfect, not since, but going back to the opium wars, of the 20th century. And it's always, drugs have been a part of America, a part of the culture.
Right. I read that the first American, I don't know if it was, I think it was the first American millionaire made his fortune on opium.
Yeah. I wouldn't be at all surprised.
What's your relationship like with your brothers today?
I have no real relationship with anyone in my family right now, except for my nephew. He reached out to me, came to a show. He's my nephew, he's 5 years younger. He's like a younger brother, you know, he's my nephew, my sister's child. And he came to an art show that I had several years ago, and we made peace. I apologized and just bawled in his arms. And he said, I forgive you. And so every birthday and Christmas, we kind of, hey, how you doing?
Yeah. Nice.
One of my older brothers is still very upset, not only about what happened to me and my mother and our mother, but the fact that I have the nerve to become popular or successful. The fact that I wrote a book and do art shows or have been in film festivals. He just can't get his head around that. So he would rather I just rot in a mental hospital somewhere. So he pops up every once in a while and gets aggressive online, on my Facebook page.
What's the name of your film and how can people get a hold of it?
I have a new film that's going to the film festivals in the winter. It's called Mad Love. Nice. Mad Love. And it's a story of Susan and I and how we met 25 years ago at a mental hospital arts program. And we've just been carrying on with the arts and the love ever since. It's going to be screened, hopefully. We don't know if it's been accepted yet. So we're going to find out if it's been accepted to Sundance in December. We're going to try and get into the Tribeca Film Festival next spring and other film festivals later next year. So
that sounds very sweet.
It is. It's the film I've been waiting to make because I've made like two or three others that have been like real gonzo kind of freakouts, you know, just kind of approximating my mental illness. But this one's really a departure.
So getting back to your book, what are the main messages of your story and to whom do you want those messages delivered to most of all?
One of the messages you touched on earlier, which is live your life, have a good time, but if you feel while smoking even the most benign of drugs, marijuana, and if you feel yourself losing grip from reality, it may be the pot. It may be the pot. And kind of slow down on it and find an alternate means, a healthier means of release. Because I was only doing it to cope with racism, with being growing up, issues of growing up, issues of racism, issues of growing up in a crazy world. So we're all need something to cope. And for God's sake, cope. But if you find that marijuana is doing you no good, try weaning yourself off. Because I wish I had someone tell me, you know, you're smoking too much. Yeah. And I also want to reach not only people who are in crisis or beginnings of crisis, but the family members of people in crisis. You know, be gentle with them, help them. Oftentimes in the Black community, at least, I'll branch off to a larger community, but in the Black community, there's not a lot of help to be had, not only through psychiatry or psychology, but even your own families sometimes are so beset with their own issues that they, you know, and it's just be gentle with them, you know, and help them any way you can.
There's a family member who serves on the board of City Voices, and she helps other family members.
Good.
And some of the people she's helping have loved ones who totally, you know, always in crisis.
Yeah.
And also violent.
Yeah.
Violent. And so violent. The family loses patience, and they start supporting things like forced treatment.
Yeah.
Like, if they're not going to willingly go into treatment, we've got to make them, force them, get a judge to sign a document and court order them.
Yeah.
Because that's the only way to, for them to be safe in their minds and for the families to be safe.
Hmm.
You got any thoughts on that?
It's a tough issue. It probably should have and would have happened to me had what happened to me not happened. So, you know, with the forced treatment comes the potential of never getting out of that hospital, you know, or perhaps spending a longer time than they would have anticipated. So it's 6 of 1, half a dozen. I mean, it's hard. It's a hard
There's issue. No easy answer.
There's no easy answer.
My last question, and I'm amazed we went through everything in less than an hour. This is incredible. My last question is one that the late, great James Lipton from Inside the Actors Studio.
Yes, love him.
He asked his guest, if heaven exists, what would you like to hear God say when you arrive at the pearly gates?
Wow. Your mother's over here and she's waiting for you. That's really all I want to hear him say. I was tempted to, I will tell you the second answer. I was tempted to hear him say, you were right all along. but that's not even important. Just to know that my mother's safe, it's fine. She's waiting for me.
Thank you, Issa, for giving us the time.
God bless
you. I'd like to splash on some of your artwork if that's okay.
Yeah.
Because I'm going to edit all this.
All right.
That would be cool. And I'll send you an email with if there's any text that you want me, I'm using a very simple video editing software. If there's any text you want me to include a black screen, white text before the interview starts, maybe something after the interview ends. So, and then once you send that to me, I'll put it all together and then I'll send you what the result is. And it'll be a YouTube video or something like that.
I hear you. I love it. I want to tell you, I trust you because your intro really just summed it up. Just your intro was really succinct and to the point and perfectly done. So I don't think I'd want to add anything more. I mean, you know, but thank you. Thank you for including the artwork. I appreciate that.
Oh man, that I appreciate it too because it's quite beautiful.
Thank you.
If you only knew how much it meant to me, you'd understand, and I would feel your love was true.